This is the third part of our series on targeting vision applications to FPGA or ASIC hardware. This part walks through many of the specific choices we made for implementing this design in hardware. All of the hardware implementation details are described in more depth in the Vision HDL Toolbox lane detection example. First, you'll notice that everything is running at the fast sample rate in red, and there are three major functions performed in hardware. Inverse perspective mapping, because in the front-facing view the lanes converge at a vanishing point, we need to convert to a bird's-eye view for further processing. Lane detection, which uses filters to identify possible lanes. And compute ego lanes, which trims down the lanes to focus only on the boundaries of the lane the vehicle is currently in. Starting with the inverse perspective mapping block, one thing you'll notice right away are the MATLAB function blocks. You can embed MATLAB code, and typically it's going to be control logic like the state machines you see here. These are remapping the pixels to spread them across the rows and expanding from a 480 by 640 matrix to a 700 by 640 matrix. We were able to generate the 700 line map from just the 50 lines around the middle of the frame, which allowed us to use on-chip block RAM as a buffer. Transforming the full incoming frame would have required off-chip RAM. This is why it's important to have an understanding of both the system requirements and the hardware architecture. Inverse perspective mapping is computationally intensive with divide operations and some tricky memory access routines. This is another collaboration point between system and hardware engineers. Because this camera is in a fixed position on the front of the car, it can be calibrated in the factory and the settings pre-programmed into lookup tables. Now I wanted to show how this block works to illustrate some of the concepts, but beginning with release 2017B, Vision HDL Toolbox has a bird's eye block available to replace all of this, where you can just input the parameters that I described here. The lane detection subsystem first applies a 2D FIR filter to the image using Vision HDL Toolbox's image filter block. This filter uses an 8x16 kernel, representing the pixel width times height of the lane markings. These marking sizes may vary by country, so while you can enter the values right here, it's good practice to use a workspace variable for easy modification. For the line buffer, you need to allocate the number of active pixels in a row, rounded up to the nearest power of 2. This is all described in the documentation for each block in Vision HDL Toolbox, but it's really nice that the tool will automatically generate the line buffer and the associated control logic. The output of this filter, shown here, then gets further processed as 18-line regions using histograms to bin the number of thresholded pixels for both the positive and negative thresholded images. The histogram block lets you define the number of bins, and it will store the bin counts in RAM. After the last pixel is read, there is a two-cycle latency before you can read the bin counts, and that data is streamed out over a number of cycles. At the same time, pixels continue to stream in, and you don't want to start overwriting data before you read it. This is why there are two of these histogram blocks here. The pixel stream will switch to the other one while the first one's histogram data is being streamed out. So we traded off more resource usage in order to keep up with the incoming pixel stream. The rest of the subsystem identifies lane candidates by multiplying the positive histogram bins by the negative to amplify the columns where lane markings are likely. It performs zero crossing filtering to get the column IDs, then stores the lane candidates for the last subsystem, which will identify the lanes that our vehicle is within. The first pass identifies the middle column of the video, our center line. The lanes closest to this are assumed to be the ego lanes, our lanes. The outlier removal block then computes the average distance from the lane markings to the center, and any lane outside a certain tolerance of that width are thrown out. This shows an advantage of hardware that you can process the left and right in parallel, but you also need to make sure their outputs are synchronized. And if I follow this path, there are 4 delays here and another 5 here. Now these could get inserted automatically during HDL code generation in order to shorten paths so we can meet our frequency goals, but it's good practice to insert them here for simulation and to ensure mapping to DSP slices. So these 9 delay blocks are here to synchronize these parallel paths. Again, HDL Coder can balance parallel paths if it inserts delays, but it's good practice to simulate them first. This block is computing the average right lane width. Since we have a stream coming in, we can't compute the overall average unless we store an entire frame to RAM and read it back out. So a trade-off we make for speed is to use a rolling window. This is a tapped delay line, so we can access the last 16 samples, add them, and then divide by 16. Now, take note of the size and precision of the result. Do we need that much precision downstream? That will be covered in part 4 of this series, which focuses on fixed point implementation and optimized HDL code generation.